going to discuss about. Okay, now we are going to discuss about the examples of this first order reactions. Okay, we have learned the integrated rate equation of first order reaction, right? Now we are going to learn certain examples for this first order reactions. So the first example. We can write the hydrogenation of ethene. Hydrogenation of ethene. What do you mean by hydrogenation? Hydrogenation. Yes. Any idea? Hydrogenation. That means addition of hydrogen. Okay. Addition of hydrogen. Addition of hydrogen. So you can write the reaction ethene. That is C2H4. Ethene. C2H4 plus H2 gives C2H6. This is an example for first order reaction. So we can write the rate of this one, K, then concentration of C2H4 raised to 1. This is the first example. Then the second one. All natural and artificial radioactive reactions. All natural and artificial radioactive decay. Radioactive decay of unstable nuclei. Unstable nuclei. All natural and artificial radioactive decay of unstable nuclei. We can write one example, Ra, it's radium. Okay. 88, it's atomic number. Then 226, it's mass number. It is decomposed or decayed to form helium-24 plus radon 86-222. This also belongs to this first order reaction.
Ma'am, can you write the name of that element?
Yes, sure. Radium RN, just then how can we write the rate equation of this reaction? Can you tell me how can we write the rate equation? We can write rate is equal to K concentration of R. Okay, these two are the examples of first order reactions. Then one more example you can write. Shall I move to next one? Next page, children? Yes. So the third one, that's the decomposition of N2O5. Decomposition of N2O5 and N2O. These two are nitrogen oxides. This is also one example for first order reaction. This is clear. Examples. First one, hydrogenation of ethene, that means the addition of hydrogen. C2H4 plus H2 giving C2H6. Second one, all natural and artificial radioactive decay of unstable nuclei. Example, radium decomposed to form helium plus radon. He stands for helium. That you already know, right? Yes. Then the third one, that is decomposition of N2O5 and N2O. Decomposition of N2O5 and N2O. This is clear about the examples. Clear, right? All of you, please switch on. Adul, can you please read the examples?
Examples for first order reaction. Mm-hmm. Hydrogenation of ethene. Yes. C2H4 plus H2 gives C2H6. Mm-hmm. All natural and artificial radioactive decay of unstable nuclei. Mm-hmm. Radium gives helium plus radon.
Yes.
Decomposition of N2O5 and N2O.
Okay. All of you, please switch on. Anna, Mehak, Anthony, Naurin, Rijas, Nia, Meenakshi, Malavika, Evelyn, Michael, Mohammed Adim, Shivani, all of you. Yes. Then next we are going to learn how to write this rate in terms of pressure. Okay. We just learned how to express this rate equation in terms of concentration, right? Concentration. But in the case of gases, we can also express it in the form of pressure. So we are going to learn how to express the rate equation in the form of pressure. Clear? In the case of gases, we need to specify the pressure also. That's why we are using this method also. Okay, so let us consider. Let us consider a first order reaction. Let us consider first order gaseous reaction. Gaseous reaction. Or otherwise, it is gas phase. Okay. That means the physical state of that substance, that is gaseous. So we can just write a reaction A, in gaseous state, gives B, that's also in gaseous state, plus C. Consider this reaction. Okay, PI, it is considered as the initial pressure. Okay, initial pressure of A. Initial pressure of A. We are just considering a reaction. A gives B and C. Both the reactants and products are in gaseous state. Then PI, it is the initial pressure of A. Then PT, this is the total pressure. The total pressure. PA stands for initial pressure of A and PT stands for total pressure. Okay, then we can write the partial pressure separately. You can write A, B and C. Then at time zero, then at T. Okay, so the initial pressure of A that we already written, it is PI. Okay, initial pressure, it is PI. That means the initial pressure of reactant, it is PI. Then in the initial state, there are no products, right? there are no products. So we can consider the pressure of B and C as zero. The initial stage only reactants are there, so we can consider the pressure of B and C. That means the products is zero. Then after the reaction proceeds at time t, we can consider the pressure of B and C as x. Okay, B and C as x. So we can write the pressure of this A. It is pi minus x. Pi minus x. Because in the initial stage, it is, yes, Achyut? Yes.
Will we take it like 2x?
We can write it separate, that's why. No need to take it as 2x. Because in all cases, there are no two products. That's why. Okay. Only need to take it as x. Okay, and all these pressures are expressed in atm. Atm is the unit of pressure, atmospheric pressure. That's it, atm. Then we can write this pt, that is the total pressure, that is equal to pa plus pb plus pc, right? Pt, that's the pressure at time t, that is the sum of partial pressures of A, B, and C. Okay. Then here we can substitute all these values. P minus x plus x plus x. Then what's the final one? P minus x plus x plus x. P minus x, that's the value of PA. Then x is the value of B, PB. Then another x, it's the value of PC. Okay. Then what's the final one? Yes, this minus x and this x is cancelled. Then pi plus x, right? Pi plus x. So pt is equal to pi minus, plus x. Any doubt, anyone? We just cancel minus x and x. Because x minus x, that is equal to zero. Right? Then one x is remaining. It is pi plus x. So here we can rewrite this one. Pt is equal to pi plus x. Pt is equal to pi plus x. Any doubt in any steps? Any doubt, children? No, right?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, then we can move to next one. Shall I move to next page? Okay, so from this equation, we can write Pt is equal to Pi plus x, right? So what is x? Pt minus Pi. Pt means the pressure at time t, and Pi means the pressure, initial pressure. Okay. Then what's the value of Pa at time t? At time t, what's the value of Pa? Yes, you can tell me. at time t, what's the value of Pa? Diya, can you tell me?
Pa plus P.
Yes. P?
Pi.
Pi?
Minus X.
Is it plus X?
Minus X.
Yes, it's minus X, right? Look here. This Pi minus X, right? So you can write there Pi minus X. Now we can substitute. We can just number this equation as 1 and this one as 2. Okay. Substitute 1 in 2. Then it becomes Pa is equal to Pi minus Pt minus Pi, right? So 2Pi minus Pt. Then at time 0, what's the value of Pa? At time 0, what's the value of Pa?
Pa.
Pi, right? Yes. So we can substitute these two values. That means initial pressure of A and the pressure of A at time t. We can substitute both these values in the equation, in the first order equation. Instead of concentration, we can write pressure. K is equal to, do you remember this equation? 2.303 by t. Then log, instead of concentration, we are going to write this pressure. Pi, that means the initial pressure, divided by the final at the time t. That means the final pressure. 2pi minus pt. Okay, this is the final equation. So in the case of gaseous components, we can also use this equation because pressure, it's mainly specified in the case of gaseous molecules. Okay, not in the case of solids and liquids. But in the case of gaseous molecules, we can use this pressure instead of concentration. This is clear, children? You can just revise from the beginning, okay? Yes. We just consider a first order gaseous reaction. That means in the gas phase, okay? A gives B plus C. Both the reactants and products are in gaseous phase. Then Pi is considered as the initial pressure of A. Okay. Then Pt is the total pressure. Then we can separately write the partial pressures of A, B, and C at time 0 and at time t. At time 0, the partial pressure of A, that is Pi, and the partial pressure of B and C, it is 0. Because in the beginning, there is no product, only reactant there, right? So no need to mention the pressure of products, that's why. Then at time t, the partial pressure of A, that is P minus X, because the partial pressure of B and C, it is X. So we can write here P minus X. Then this Pt, Pt means pressure at the time t, that is equal to Pa plus Pb plus Pc. That means partial pressures of A, B, and C. Then we can substitute these values. For Pa, we can write P minus X. Then for Pb, it is X. Pc, it is X. Minus X and X cancelled. Then the final one, Pi plus X. Okay. Then in the next step, we can write X from that equation. X equal to Pt minus Pi. Then at time t, Pa is equal to Pi minus X. Then we can substitute the value of X in this equation. Pa is equal to Pi minus Pt minus Pi. So it is 2pi minus pt. So we got the initial and final pressure of A. So we can substitute, because it is the reactant, right? That's why we are substituting the value of A, initial pressure and final pressure. K is equal to 2.303 by T log pi divided by 2pi minus pt. This is clear. Any doubt? We can compare this one with the previous equation. That means 2.303 by T log concentration of R0 divided by concentration of R. Instead of concentration, here we are using pressure. That's the difference. Okay. Any doubt? This is Sneha in your class? No, right? Sneha. Any other siblings in this name? Just wait. All of you, please switch on your videos. So any doubt in this portion, children? Nothing, no, right? No. Yes. So shall I move to next one? Yes, right? So next one is half-life. Okay. Half-life of first order and zero order reaction. So you can write the heading. Half-life. Half-life of a reaction. What do you mean by this half-life? Anyone define? Can you able to define half-life? Anna, Lydia, Alvin, Muhammad, Adi, Mahak, Anthony, Naurin, Ari, and Donna. Can you please switch on your videos? Yes. Then anyone, please define half-life. Nandana, can you define?
I don't know.
Okay. So we can define this half-life. It is the time in which the concentration of reactant is reduced to its half. Okay, so you can write the half-life of a reaction. Half-life of a reaction is the time in which the concentration of reactants is reduced to one half of its initial concentration. Okay, it is represented as T half. T, then subscript half. So half-life of a reaction, it is a time in which the concentration of reactant is reduced to one half of its initial concentration. Okay. Then we can derive the half-life of zero order reaction and first order reaction. Lydia, can you please read this definition of half-life?
Half-life of a reaction is the time in which concentration of reactant is reduced to one half of its initial concentration. It is represented as T half.
Okay. Then you can write the heading for zero order reactions. For zero order reactions. Can you tell me how to determine the rate constant in zero order reactions? What's the equation to find out the rate constant in zero order reaction? Sharon, can you tell me?
K is equal to concentration R zero minus concentration R by T.
Yes, very good. Concentration of R zero minus concentration of R divided by T. This is the equation of rate constant in the case of zero order reaction. So we are calculating the half life of this zero order reaction, right? Half life of zero order reaction. So we can take at time T half. Okay. Here the time is T half and the concentration of R is equal to half concentration of R zero. Okay. That means half the value of initial concentration. That's it. Concentration of R is equal to half concentration of R zero. Okay, then we can substitute these two values in this equation. K is equal to concentration of R zero minus concentration of, sorry, half into concentration of R zero divided by T half. Right? We just substitute the value of T and concentration of R in this equation. Then we can rewrite this equation in the form of T half. T half is equal to R zero. What is R zero minus half R zero? Yes, it's half R zero, right? Divided by K. Or otherwise, we can write this one. Just 1 minute, children. Is concentration of R zero divided by 2K. Okay. T half is equal to concentration of R zero by 2K. So this is the final equation. T half is equal to concentration of R zero divided by 2K. This is the half life of zero order reactions. Half life of zero order reaction. So from this equation, we can write, if as you can complete this equation, then we can move to next one. Finish, children. Shall I move to next page? Okay, T half is equal to concentration of R zero by 2k. So from this equation, we can write T half is directly proportional to concentration of R0 and T half is inversely proportional to rate constant. Okay. Directly proportional to initial concentration of the reactant. Then in the second one, it is inversely proportional to rate constant. This is clear? Directly proportional to initial. Yes.
We have 1 by 2k, right?
Yes.
So can we say it is inversely proportional to rate constant or twice rate constant?
No need to mention that. Just write this one inversely proportional to rate constant. That means opposite to that. That's it. If the concentration of, that means initial concentration increases, the half-life also increases. If the rate constant decreases, half-life increases. Okay, that's it. Other thing also increases. Inversely proportional is just opposite to each other. This is clear. Shall I move to next one? Then next one is half-life of first order reaction. Any doubt in this portion? Nothing. Okay. Then next one, four first order reactions. Four first order reactions. Can you tell me what's the equation of rate constant in the case of first order reactions? K is equal to? Shivani, can you tell me? Equation of rate constant K. Yes. Tell me. That's in the form of base 10. That's it. 2.303 by. Not audible. Tania, can you tell me?
1/3 into.
Huh?
1/3 log molar concentration.
Not that one. It's in the form of base 10. We just convert this natural logarithm to base 10, right? That's starting with 2.303 by T. Last one, K is equal to yes. In the derivation, the last equation of first order,
K is equal to 2.303 by T.
Yes.
Log molar concentration R0. By molar concentration R.
Yes. Okay. So this is the equation, right? Here also we can substitute at T is equal to T half. Then R is equal to R zero by 2. Okay. R zero by 2 or half R zero. So we can rewrite this equation. K is equal to 2.303 by T half log concentration of R zero divided by concentration of R zero by 2. Okay, then we can rewrite it in terms of T half. Sorry, T half. 2.303 by K. Then here these two cancel, right? Low concentration of R zero divided by concentration of R zero by 2. Then it is log 2. Okay, then we can substitute the value of log 2. Just 1 minute, children. Log 2, its value is 0.301. Okay, log 2, it is 0.301. So 2.303 into, here it is pi k, 0.301. So the final answer becomes T half is equal to 0.693 divided by K. This is the half-life of first order reaction. T half is equal to 0.693 divided by K. So here the half-life of first order reaction is a constant. That means does not depend on the concentration, initial concentration. Okay. In the case of zero order reaction, this half-life, it is directly proportional to the initial concentration of reactant and inversely proportional to the rate constant. Here, this half-life of first-order reaction is considered as a constant because it does not depend on the initial concentration, only depend on rate constant, that is same as in the zero-order reaction. This is clear. Any doubt? So now we just learned the half-life of first order reaction and zero order reaction, right? So the half-life of a reaction, it is the time in which the concentration of reactant is reduced to one half of its initial concentration. And it is represented as T half, small letter T. Then as a subscript, you can write half. Then we just find out the half-life of zero order reaction. For that, we are using this equation, integrated rate equation for this constant, rate constant. That is K is equal to molar concentration of R zero minus molar concentration of R divided by T. Then we substitute T half for T and half R zero for R. Then finally we got T half is equal to concentration of R zero divided by 2K. That means that half-life, which is directly proportional to the initial concentration and inversely proportional to the rate constant. That's in the case of zero order reaction. Then The next one, in the case of first order reaction, we just write the value equation of rate constant, K is equal to 2.303 by T log concentration of R0 divided by R. Then we substitute T half for T and R0 by 2 for R. Finally, we got the equation T half is equal to 0.693 divided by K. That means half-life of first order reaction, it is independent of initial concentration of reactant. That's it. This is clear? Is clear, children? Okay, so there is difference in many factors in the case of the zero order reaction and first order reaction. All of you, please switch on your videos. The differential rate law, it is different for first order reaction and zero order reaction. Then the next one, integrated rate law, it is different for first order reaction, zero order reaction. Then the half-life and units also different for zero order reaction and first order reaction. There is one table in your textbook, page number 111. Okay, you can just go through that table after this class. Okay, table 4.4. Okay, then there is one more topic in this section, that is pseudo first order reaction, that we can discuss in the next class. Okay, all of you please go through the old steps of this derivations, including the integrated rate equation and this half-life of both first order reaction and zero order reaction. If you feel any doubt in any portion, you can ask me. Okay, children, then let me take your attendance, just wait.